Hello everyone. In this video, we're going to dive into some volumes by slicing examples, but we're just going to be doing the general slicing method. In the next video, we'll get more into solids and revolutions, which I'll talk about in that last example today. So, the general slicing method, we're going to basically expand upon the area we just learned how to calculate, the area between those two curves, or the region between those two curves, but now we're going to be finding the volume. The method for general slicing is fairly simple and kind of intuitive. You're going to suppose that a solid's cross section or slices are perpendicular to the x-axis. So if they're perpendicular to the x-axis, we're going to be slicing parallel with that y-axis. And there's some area that's given by a function a that is integrable on a to b, meaning that it's continuous and we can indeed integrate along that interval. The volume of the solid is going to be that b is equal to the integral from a to b, that interval, of the area with respect to x. So there's our function, the area of x, and that's with respect to x. So all we're going to do is find the area and then integrate that to find the volume. So if you think about when we originally found the area, we took the height of a rectangle and multiplied it by that width dx. Now we're taking the area and multiplying it again by some width, so multiplying by another length, that's going to be a volume. Let's jump into example one so that we can kind of visualize and understand exactly what's happening. For example one, it says to use the general slicing method, which we talked about above, to find the volume of a solid whose base is the region in the first quadrant, which I've graphed here, bounded by the curve y equals the square root of x and x equals 4, also pictured below, and whose cross sections through the solid are perpendicular to the x-axis and their squares. So when we're talking about these cross sections, I want us to visualize slicing some solid. So our slices are going to be perpendicular to that x-axis, sliced like so. The other given information is that those cross sections are squares. And we use this piece of information to find the area. Because if you can envision a square has the same length times the height. The sides are all equivalent. So to find the area, we need to multiply just two sides together. So if my cross section is here, well, what's that height? The height from the axis to one, because we're finding the volume of a solid within this region, our height is one. Because if we plugged one in for x, the square root of one is equal to one. So we have a height of one, but all the way over here at our upper bound, we have a height of two for that cross section. Or over here at the start, our height is zero. So our height is changing, and it's changing according to the function. So the height at any given point is that function. And if we're dealing with a cross section that's a square, well, then our area with respect to x is going to be our function, because that's one side of the square, times itself. So the function of our area is equal to x, because the square root of x times the square root of x equals x. And what we're going to do is we're going to integrate that from our starting point of 0 to 4, and that's x dx. You can see that this is the area times some other length. That's going to give us volume. Now, before we actually evaluate this integral, let's think about this picture in three dimensions. So if this is my x-axis and this is my y-axis, if I was to picture this in three dimensions, we're going to have some other axis or some third dimension, let's call it z. So some x, y, and z. So if you can envision me taking this, flattening it on a piece of paper, and we're going to extend out of that. So I'm going to draw my x-axis at an angle. Here is going to be my y-axis. And I'm going to draw the same exact thing in two dimensions. So you can see that we have our square root of x function, and here is where x is equal to 4. So you can see I took that same exact picture, and I just angled it a bit. That way we can visualize we have some other axis coming out of here, and we'll go ahead and call that the z-axis, which at this point in time is not too important to us. We just want to visualize this in three dimensions. So let's go ahead and draw one of the squares, because remember our cross section is perpendicular. So if I draw that same exact length, you can see that I roughly have one of those cross sections. Or if I drew it over here, you can see this square is going to be a little bit bigger because the height of the function at that point is larger. Or I can draw a square over here, and you can kind of get the idea if you were to visualize this solid. Let me go switch to a different color, and I'll connect the edges of the squares together so you can kind of see that we'll have some solid that looks like so. And that's because our slices are squares. As you can see, I'm not the best artist, but if you can visualize those cross sections and then connecting those together, that's the solid we're forming with this general slicing method. So let me go ahead and get rid of this, and let's go ahead and calculate the volume of that solid. So what we're going to do is we're going to integrate our area of x, because remember, each of those square slices had a side of the square root of x. And square root of x times the square root of x is x. So that's the area of that square. And we're going to integrate that with respect to x from the bounds 0 to 4. So that'll be x squared over 2 from 0 to 4. Plugging in 4, we'll get 4 squared over 2. Plugging in 0, 0 squared over 2 is just 0. So 4 squared over 2 is 16 over 2 minus 0, which gives us 8. So the volume, using the general slicing method for the region bounded in the first quadrant by the curve y equals square root of x and x equals 4, is 8 units cubed because it's a volume. Now let's move on to number 2. In number 2, again, we're going to use that general slicing method. So we're going to find the area and integrate that. So it says that the base is bounded by the curve y equals 4 minus x squared, which you can see the curve there, and y equals 0, which is that x-axis. So the base is between those two curves. Again, our cross-section is perpendicular to that x-axis, except this time we're not going to be slicing it and having square slices, we're going to be having quarter circular disc slices. So not quite a semicircle, but just a quarter of a circle. So using that information, let's think about the area of a circle. The area of a circle is pi r squared, but we have a quarter of that circle, so our area formula is going to be 1/4 pi r squared. We just have to figure out what this radius is. So our a of x is going to be 1/4 pi, and then our radius squared. So let's try to envision this in three dimensions so we can figure out what that radius is. Here I'll draw my x-axis, my y-axis, and then we have some axis z as well, which is going to give us that third dimension. I'll go ahead and draw my parabola, y equals 4 minus x squared. So there we have it. If you can envision a slice, our slice is running parallel to that y-axis or perpendicular to that x-axis and the quarter circle slice that we're getting from this solid. Starting my slice here, a quarter circle would look something like this. Over here, doing another quarter circle, you can see this one's going to be much bigger. Then we'll get to our biggest one, which lies on that axis. And then we'll start shrinking back down again, doing those quarter circles because our function is now getting smaller. So if you can envision this, our figure is going to be like a half dome shape. And remember, we said that those slices formed quarter circles. Our radius is going to be from our x-axis to our function. That is our radius r. And what's that distance? Well, that distance is our function. So our area is going to be a of x equals 1/4 pi times our function, because that's the height of those cross sections, or the radius of those cross sections, which that function was 4 minus x squared. And remember, if that's our radius, we also have to square that. So each of these individual slices that I have pictured below is going to be whatever x value we're at, 4 minus that x value squared times 1/4 pi. So let's go ahead and calculate that area. Remember, volume equals our area with respect to x from our bounds. In this case, our bounds go from negative 2 to 2. Another way to do this is realize that we have a symmetrical figure, and I'm actually going to rewrite this volume as 0 to 2, so taking into account half that figure, and I'll multiply that answer by 2. And I'll go ahead and integrate that area with respect to x. So that's going to be 1/4 pi times my radius, which is my function, squared. Let's go ahead and simplify this before we start integrating. So I'm gonna bring my 1/4 pi out in front to get 2/4 pi, or 1/2 pi. And then I'll go ahead and expand out my 4 minus x squared. So 4 minus x squared is going to be 16 minus 8x squared plus x to the 4th. And that was just me expanding that out in my head. So let's go ahead and integrate each of those terms. We'll leave our 1/2 pi out in front. 16, integrating that, becomes 16x. 8x squared, integrating that, becomes 8x cubed over 3. And then integrating x to the 4th becomes x to the 5th over 5. And we're doing this from, remember we're doing half of it because we multiplied it by 2, so that's going to go from 0 to 2. Now, I'll just plug in 2 and then subtract plugging in 0. So we'll get 1/2 pi times 16 times 2, which is 32, minus 2 cubed is 8. 8 times 8 is 64, so that'll be 64/3, plus x to the 5th is 32, and that's all over 5, and I'm subtracting, plugging in 0, which is going to be 0. I'll just simplify this down to get my volume of the solid with slices that are quarter circles. What I'm going to do first is find a common denominator so I can combine everything together. So I'll still have 1/2 pi out in front, but my common denominator between 3 and 5 is going to be 15. So I'll write 32 in terms of 15ths. So 32 times 15 is going to be 480 over 15. I'll subtract, multiplying 64 by 5, which is 320. So that's 320 over 15. And then I'll add that to multiplying 32 by 3, which is going to be 96 over 15. So I'll have 1/2 pi times, combining those together, 480 minus 320 leaves me with 160. And when I add that to 96, I'll get 256 over 15. Now 15 doesn't go into that, but if I distributed that 1/2 in, I can simplify this down. Dividing 256 by 2 is going to be 128. So the volume is going to be 128 pi over 15. And I think this last example is a great lead-in into what we're going to do within our next example video, which you probably covered in the lesson. It's going to be another way of using a slice method, except this time, as opposed to slicing some general area, we're going to be slicing a solid of revolution. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be taking whatever our function is, and as opposed to building it up to form some general volume, we're going to take that function and revolve it around a given axis or a given line. And if you think about when we go to revolve that around and then slicing those cross sections, those are going to be discs. So this is going to lead right into solids of revolution in the next video, where you'll see we'll keep on using this pi r squared concept for our area, integrating that to get volume. So stay tuned and we'll go through a couple of examples with that. But until next time, good luck with your online learning.